Before central heating, you might think people just used fireplaces to stay warm, but there were dozens of innovative inventions between then and now that kept people warm on the coldest nights. Hi everyone, Ken here. Hit that subscribe button and let's discover the creative ways people used to stay warm before modern technology. For thousands of years, an open fire was the only source of warmth. Prehistoric humans gathered around campfires and hearths. Indoor heating remained simple and smoky for millennia. In the ancient world, some clever systems appeared. The Greeks and Romans, for example, developed rudimentary central heating in large buildings. The Romans used the hypocausts system, which channeled hot air under floors and through walls to heat villas and bathhouses. This underfloor heating of Rome, and similarly, the ondol floor heating in ancient Korea, was remarkable for its time. However, such systems were complex and mostly reserved for the wealthy. After the Roman Empire fell, Europe largely returned to simpler fireplaces for nearly 1,000 years. By the Middle Ages, the fireplace had evolved as the center of home heating. Medieval halls featured large open hearths, and by around the 12th to 14th centuries, the invention of the chimney made indoor fires much more practical by venting smoke outside, a game changer for comfort. Still, heating was inefficient, only the area right near the fire stayed truly warm, and tending the fire was a constant chore. People cope by bundling up in layers of wool, clustering in the warmest room, and using creative tricks. Colonial Americans, for instance, would employ heavy bed curtains, thick blankets, and press warming pans filled with hot coals to preheat their beds on frigid nights. Even then, on the coldest days, the far corners of a room might stay freezing despite a roaring fireplace. Starting in the 17th and 18th centuries, stoves began to supplement or even replace open fireplaces. A major breakthrough came in the American colonies in 1741 when Benjamin Franklin invented his famous cast iron Franklin stove. Franklin's Pennsylvania fireplace was a metal-lined stove that sat partially on the fireplace and vented smoke through an angled flue. It produced more heat with less wood than an open hearth, and with far less smoke leaking into the room. Franklin's invention was safer and more efficient, quickly gaining popularity and inspiring further stove designs. Around the same time, Sir Benjamin Thompson in Europe was also improving fireplaces. In the 1790s, he designed a Rumford fireplace, a tall, shallow fireplace with angled sides to reflect heat and a streamlined chimney throat to carry smoke away efficiently. Rumford's design became state-of-the-art by the turn of the 19th century. His fireplaces were widely built, and they were admired for being much cleaner and hotter burning than old designs. By the late 18th century, thanks to innovators like Franklin and Rumford, the average home's fireplace or stove was far more efficient than in earlier years. But these were still essentially local heaters, a fire in each room or a single stove that couldn't heat a whole building evenly. The stage was set for the next leap, finding ways to distribute warmth around a home or larger structure. The early 19th century would bring the dawn of central heating as inventors began experimenting with furnaces, ducts, steam, and hot water to spread heat beyond the fireplace. As the Industrial Revolution got underway, inventors on both sides of the Atlantic started reimagining how a building could be heated. The key idea was central heating, having one heat source warm multiple rooms via some heat distribution system. One early visionary was an English writer, Hugh Platt, who as far back as 1594 proposed using steam to heat a greenhouse. His idea didn't advance at the time, but it foreshadowed things to come. In the late 1700s, the famous steam engine inventor James Watt actually applied steam heating in his own home in England. He used a primitive steam boiler and even a crude radiator made of soldered copper sheets to warm his house. Around the same time in France, a man named Bonnemann developed a hot water heating system for growing plants, which was an early hydronic heating experiment. And in Russia, the summer palace of Peter the Great reportedly had a basic hot water central heating system by 1710, showing that the idea of warming multiple rooms from one source was percolating in different places. The first systems that truly resemble modern central heating began appearing around the turn of the 19th century. In the United States, an important milestone was achieved by Daniel Pettibone, an American inventor in the early 1800s. Inspired by ancient Roman ideas, Pettibone built what is considered the first warm air furnace for building heating. In 1800, he installed a system at the Pennsylvania Hospital in Philadelphia that had a basement furnace heating air, which then rose naturally through ducts into the rooms above. This gravity-driven warm air system suffered from uneven heating. Hot air would collect upstairs while lower rooms stayed cool, but it proved the concept that you could heat multiple rooms from one furnace. Meanwhile, in England, engineers were tackling the same problem. In 1805, William Strutt of Derby designed a pioneering warm air furnace for a mill building. Strutt's furnace was an iron fire chamber encased in brick, which heated air drawn from outside and channeled it through ducts around the building. A few years later, Strutt and his collaborator Charles Sylvester applied a similar central hot air system to heat Derby's Royal Infirmary Hospital in 1819. With remarkable success, patients enjoyed warm air and foul air was vented out through a dome. These English systems were influential and widely copied in new factories and institutions during the early 19th century. By 1816, central heating had its first foothold in American building design. That year, the Massachusetts Medical College in Boston became the first U.S. building to be centrally heated. It used a gravity hot air system with a basement furnace and ductwork to distribute warm air upstairs, much like Pettibone's concept. By the 1820s and 1830s, inventors such as A.M. Perkins were developing high-pressure hot water systems. Perkins, an American-born engineer working in London, devised a system in 1831 using small-diameter wrought iron pipes coiled in a furnace. The hot water would circulate through these pipes to heat rooms, sometimes via baseboard-style radiators. This high-pressure, hot water heating was effective, if a bit dangerous at first with several reported explosions. Nonetheless, it saw use in England for a couple of decades. Perkins' son and other associates later brought these ideas back to the US. In 1842, Joseph Nason and James Walworth introduced Perkins' hot water system to America, installing some of the first hot water central heating in US buildings. All these developments by the mid-19th century meant that the age of true central heating was dawning. Furnaces with ducts could warm multiple rooms, boilers with pipes could circulate heat via steam or water. These basic elements of modern heating were falling into place. However, a key component was still evolving: how to effectively deliver the heat into the rooms. This is where the next big innovations come in, the invention of the radiator. During the mid-1800s, the Industrial Revolution provided both the need and the technological know-how for more advanced heating systems. Cities were growing, factories and schools needed heating, and new fuels like coal were widely available. In response, inventors perfected the use of steam and hot water heating and introduced the cast iron radiators that would become a staple of central heating. A breakthrough came from the US in 1854, when Connecticut stovemaker Stephen Gould invented the first effective radiator device. Gould's radiator, nicknamed the mattress radiator, was made of two iron sheets riveted together, creating channels for steam. Importantly, Gould's radiator included a safety valve so that once steam filled the device, excess pressure could vent out, preventing explosions. This meant steam systems could operate at lower, safer pressures and be regulated without constant manual adjustment. Around the same time in St. Petersburg, a Prussian-born Russian businessman named Franz Singali was also making history with radiators. Singali is credited with inventing the classic cast iron sectional radiator around 1855 to 1857. His radiator design, essentially a series of vertical cast iron columns that could be fed with hot water or steam, was a major step toward modern central heating. By the late 19th century, Victorian cast iron radiators based on these designs had become widespread, particularly in Europe and the United States. Companies like the American Radiator Company, founded in 1891, sprang up to mass-produce radiators and boilers, making cast iron radiators almost ubiquitous in new buildings by the end of the century. While steam and hot water systems were taking off for larger buildings and upscale homes, many ordinary people in the 19th century still kept warm with cast iron wood stoves and coal stoves. The classic potbelly stove and similar cast iron heaters were common sights in homes, schools, and train stations. These stoves could burn coal, a fuel that became increasingly important in the late 1800s. In fact, 1885 is a notable year in heating history. It's cited as the point when coal overtook wood as the primary heating fuel in the United States and other developed countries. Coal was delivered by the cartload to homes, where it fed basement furnaces or parlor stoves, providing steady heat, albeit with a lot of ash to clean up. Whole industries grew around coal heating. Many urban homes had a gravity furnace in the cellar, essentially a big cast iron firebox that heated air which rose through ducts to the rooms. These early furnaces had no electric blower, relying on the natural rise of hot air. They were often fed with coal by hand and could be converted to burn wood as well. As the 19th century progressed, the technology of central heating became more refined and widespread. By the 1870s and 1880s, if you walked into a wealthy home or modern city building, you might find cast iron radiators in the rooms connected to a basement steam boiler. One popular radiator design was invented by Nelson Bundy in 1874, the Bundy Loop Sectional Radiator, which was highly effective and easy to manufacture. Thanks to such innovations, by the 1880s, cast iron radiators were commonly adopted, creating a true central heating experience. You could have a single boiler heating water or steam that traveled by pipe into every room's radiator, spreading warmth throughout the entire structure. Another critical piece of the heating puzzle was control, how to regulate temperature and not overheat or waste fuel. This led to the invention of the thermostat. The first thermostats appeared in the early 19th century. In 1830, an Englishman named Andrew Ure patented a bimetallic thermostat device. This early thermostat could respond to temperature changes, however, it was later in the century that thermostats really took off. In 1883, a young schoolteacher in Wisconsin named Warren S. Johnson grew tired of the inconsistent heating in his classroom. He invented an automatic thermostat that used compressed air to regulate a steam heating system. Johnson patented his thermostat in 1885, and it allowed people to finally set a desired temperature and have the heating system self-adjust. By 1900, the elements of central heating we recognize today, furnaces or boilers in the basement, radiators or ducts in each room, and thermostatic controls, were all in place. Yet it's worth noting, in 1900, central heating was still not in every home. It was common in city apartments and public buildings, but many rural dwellings or older homes still relied on stoves or fireplaces. Even as late as 1940, about 75% of American homes were still heated by wood or coal as the primary fuel. The 20th century was a boom time for central heating in America and beyond. Rapid urbanization and improvements in technology led to central heating systems becoming standard in new construction. A key transition was the move from coal and manual furnaces to cleaner fuels and automated systems. Fuels were also changing. Gas and oil emerged as new heating fuels in the 20th century. Natural gas had been used for lighting throughout the 1800s, but by the 1910s and 1920s, it began to be used for heating as gas pipeline networks expanded. An important visionary was Alice H. Parker, an African-American inventor in New Jersey, who in 1919 patented a device for a natural gas central heating furnace. Parker's system was ahead of its time. It proposed a furnace with gas burners and ducts to individual rooms, and even the concept of individually controlled vents. This was essentially an early blueprint for the modern forced air gas furnace heating system. While her specific design wasn't built immediately, it was a significant step toward using cleaner fuels and zone controls in home heating. By the 1920s, oil-burning furnaces also became available as an alternative to coal. Oil heaters, burning kerosene or heating oil, started appearing in that decade. These new fuels meant homeowners could have heat at the turn of a valve, without hauling coal or wood. However, adoption was gradual. Many homes stuck with coal through the 1930s because it was cheap and familiar. One reason central heating became more widespread in this era was the introduction of electricity into homes, enabling new accessories for heating systems. Another electrical innovation came with controls. Early thermostats had been mechanical or pneumatic, but by the 1910s, systems with electrically operated gas valves were developed, so a thermostat could directly turn the burner on and off. During this period, the building science of heating also leapt forward in terms of insulation and safety. Previously, most homes had little to no insulation. Heat easily escaped through walls and roofs. In the 1920s, some tried using sawdust, wool, or even newspaper as insulation with limited success, and with problems like attracting rodents and easily catching fire. In the 1930s, chemistry provided a solution. Fiberglass insulation was invented, which could cheaply and effectively insulate walls and attics. Unfortunately, the 1930s also saw the rise of asbestos use for insulation in furnace linings, effective at the time but later found to be extremely hazardous. Better insulation meant that homes could stay warm with less fuel, making central heating more efficient and affordable. By the late 1930s, central heating was truly going mainstream in American homes. The first U.S. company to mass-market home furnaces, Richardson & Boynton Company, ramped up production in these years, signaling that factory-made furnaces were available for the average consumer. World War II and the economic boom that followed would rapidly change home heating. The post-war housing explosion in the 1940s and 1950s led to millions of new homes being built with modern central heating installed from day one. In 1940, only about 15% of U.S. homes had central heating systems, but by 1960, an estimated 66% of all homes built in the U.S. had central heating systems installed. The trend was clear. The era of each room having its own stove was over. Central heating had become a standard feature for comfort and convenience. Outside of preference and affordability, utilities expanded natural gas service to more cities and suburbs, and by the 1960s, natural gas had become the dominant heating fuel in the U.S., making these installs not only possible, but practical. With central heating now ubiquitous, the focus shifted to improving efficiency and control. One important innovation was the zoned heating system, the ability to heat different parts of a house to different temperatures on a different schedule. While early systems like Alice Parker's designs had envisioned individually controlled burners for different zones, Practical zoning in homes became easier with advancements in electric dampers and multiple thermostats in the mid to late 20th century. Homeowners could, for example, keep bedrooms cooler at night and living areas warmer in the evening automatically. The thermostat itself evolved from a simple dial on the wall to a smart electronic device. The first programmable thermostats appeared in this era, allowing setback temperatures at night or when the house was empty. Another mid-century development was the integration of forced air heating with ventilation and air conditioning, what we now call HVAC systems. The same ducts that delivered warm air in winter could also distribute cool air from a central air conditioner in summer. This meant year-round climate control. In more recent decades, innovative heating technologies have emerged that go beyond the old furnace and boiler paradigm. One example is the heat pump, an electrically powered device that can both heat and cool a home by moving heat in or out. Heat pumps have been available since the mid-20th century, but only in recent decades have they become efficient enough to rival traditional furnaces in cold climates. Modern air source and geothermal heat pumps can warm a house with a fraction of the energy that electric resistance heating would use. In a sense, the heat pump is a futuristic twist. Instead of generating heat by burning fuel, it transfers existing heat from the outdoor air or ground into the home. Radiant heating has also made a comeback in modern times. Floors warmed by electric mats are a luxury feature in some homes today. Amusingly, this new trend brings us full circle. It harks back to the Roman hypocausts or the Korean ondol, which we talked about earlier. Looking back, it's striking how each era built upon the last. We went from huddling around open fires to mastering fire and controlled stoves and fireplaces, to distributing warmth through ducts and pipes, to automating and fine-tuning it with thermostats and smart technology. The innovations in the Industrial Revolution were the stepping stones that led to the cozy living we enjoy today. And with that, I'll turn it over to you. Which type of heating method do you prefer, or maybe something else stuck out to you? Either way, let me know down below in the comments section, and while you're there, make sure you're subscribed so you never miss an exciting episode of This House.